And welcome to our first webinar of 2024. We are absolutely thrilled to have you here. You can't go wrong with the Carpenters. My name is Allison O'Connor. I'm with CSU Extension in Larimer County. I am joined by my colleague, Dr. Tony Koskin, who's the turf specialist, and our incredible presenter, Dr. Chad Miller, who I will introduce momentarily. Just a couple of housekeeping things before we get started. This webinar is being recorded, and we also want to let you know that CSU is an equal opportunity access and non-discrimination university. If there is anything we can do to accommodate your needs, please let us know. We will be here to facilitate questions and also help you with anything else that you might come across. As I mentioned, this webinar is being recorded, so if you need to leave today or you get cut off, we will post it on the cohort's blog. We'll be sure to put that in the chat so you can not only register for upcoming webinars, but you can check out webinars that we have recorded in the past. And we are continuing these webinars every month on the second Wednesday. The webinars are posted through June, and I will get the rest of the year up very soon. So join us next month on wonderful Valentine's Day, February 14th, for a session with myself and Kathy on a totally biased perennials perspective. So you can click the QR code, you can scan that. We'll also put that link into the chat so you can get registered in February. Without further ado, I'm so pleased to introduce you to Dr. Chad Miller. He joined CSU from Kansas State about a year ago, so he has 12 months under his belt. He is our ornamental horticulturalist and also helps coordinate, or does coordinate, the CSU trial gardens, including both Plant Select, the perennials garden, and the annuals. So he's going to talk about the best ofs from 2023 and all of the amazing research that he did this last year. So take it away, Chad. Thanks for joining us.
Yes, thanks, Allison. And thanks for everybody joining today. I will go ahead and get started because I have, 53 slides. I can talk a lot and I won't get through all the plants that I have on here to share. And so why don't I go ahead and get, do you want to continue? And here, so hopefully everybody should see my PowerPoint at this point. And I'm going to actually turn off my camera so you are not looking at me and rather looking at the plant. So,
and Chad, so we see your presenter view. So if you just want to switch that, if you're able to.
Can you
perfect.
See?
Yes, there that is go. Awesome. Yep. Thank you.
Okay. It is my two screens that I was looking at the wrong one. So as Allison said, I joined our ranks here just over a year ago. And so I'm happy to be here, glad to be here, and was really involved with the trials. And so just some of you may have already met me, seen my presentation or so, but I always like to try to share a little bit about myself. That is me. I have no problem sharing some of my earlier pictures. But if anybody gets to know me, has heard of me, I love bulbs. And so if anybody could guess that plant there, that's a dahlia, that's cultivar duet. And so it may not show up, but I'm extremely excited about plants there. But that's me, dahlias. Dahlias were my plant that got me really into horticulture. And so I'm originally from Wisconsin, and so I grew up in just on across the border from Minneapolis, St. Paul. Here, why don't I get out? I can here, a laser pointer. So I grew up just outside of Minneapolis, St. Paul, in northwest Wisconsin. And as Allison mentioned, I came here from Kansas State University, where I was for a little over 12 years. So I always share a little bit of background information about the CSU Trail Gardens. So we are all sort of on the same playing field. It was initiated back in 74 over at the former PERC, or Plant Environmental Research Center, which is where the stadium is currently located. Back in 2000, so we're approaching almost 25 years now, moved over to the current location over between College Ave and Remington. And so it's a pretty high visible spot where we see over 25,000 passerbys and cars at least every day. It's the former city park for Fort Collins, and it's in front of the former Fort Collins High School. So it's just a little under 2 or 3, excuse me, 3 acres between the annual garden, which you're seeing mostly here from the aerial vision on the right, and the perennial garden, which is immediately in front of the Fort Collins High School there, Old Fort Collins High School. The trail gardens are a self-supporting activity. That means basically it's supported by the entry fees. So all the different plants that you see entered in the trials and the annuals and the perennials, the breeders or the plant purveying companies pay us to trial them and provide them with some data. And that is what is our primary support. There are some donations from horticultural enterprises and local community members, et cetera, that help with the gardens. Master gardeners do a lot of volunteering out there. Thank you very much. And so it's a very self-supporting activity. Might be a little bit partial, but we are considered one of the top university trials in the U.S. Probably us being number one, and then UGA, University of Georgia, being maybe number two, and maybe University of Pennsylvania, Penn State, being number three. So, but our major objective at the Flower Trial Gardens is to provide some objective reviews of the plants. We plant them, we grow them very straightforward, and we provide a report so the companies and the general public can see how these plants perform in our high desert or steppe region area here in Fort Collins. We do have an advisory board. It consists of about 25 or so local and national industry members. Probably need to add international industry members in there as well. Occasionally have somebody from overseas on there. But they provide us feedback and help make sure that we are doing the best we can in the trial gardens. Most of you might be aware of this, but we are sitting at right about 5,000 foot elevation. We are USDA 5B. The newest zone classifications didn't really shift us that much. That's a whole other conversation about the USDA hardiness zones, but we won't go there today. On average, we see about 15 inches of precipitation here. Average highs in the 85 area in the summer, and lows in the 30, right around freezing mark, 34, 32 degrees. Just a few cultural information for folks, and you can also find this in our report if you go to the CSU Trail webpage, which I have that coming up in a minute. We do put out a report. The annual one is a little over 350-ish pages, and the perennial one's right around 120-ish or so. But we do post all of this information in there, so if you want to get more details and more specifics, you can certainly access those. But regarding irrigation in our trial gardens, we apply three different rates: a low, medium, or high, 0.5, 1, or 1.5 inches, and 2 or 3 times a week, depending on the location and the crop. And then we have 500, 600 containers out there, and they receive irrigation 45 minutes twice a day, and those that are in the shade for 30 minutes. Fertilization, we do a pre-plant and we do during the growing season. So we put out in the ground beds a general 14-5-5. And then in the containers, we do a slow release Osmocote of 14-14-14. And then during the growing season, we start off in a 2010-20 to kind of help push a little bit of growth. And then we dial it back just a little bit after the first couple of weeks and to a 14-4-14 for the rest of the season. And so they're basically fertigated. So when we apply the irrigation, they are getting fertilized. Maintenance in the garden is minimal. Obviously, we pull out weeds and things all around the plants, but true purpose of the trials is to see how plants perform. And so we don't do a lot of deadheading. We do do a couple of crops, geraniums and dahlias, and that's usually in reference or timing wise for our annual evaluation day, industry evaluation day, which is in early August. And so because we can kind of have a little cycle of flowering and larger bloom periods, we will deadhead a few weeks ahead of time to make sure the evaluators can actually see a bit more of the flowers on the plants. Otherwise, most all the rest of the crops, we allow them to run their course, and we don't do a lot of maintenance in that regard. Always get questions about pesticide. We do minimal pesticide applications. If we do perceive a major outbreak that is on our doorstep, obviously a big part of this display and trial garden is a display garden as well, and we'd prefer not a whole bed to be lost to any sort of pathogen. So we will put minimal pesticides on if needed. But again, we generally don't do that because also these companies that are putting out the new flowers or the products are also working to breed for resistance anyways. And so we do kind of want to test that to see just how resistant or they hold up to any sort of pathogen pressure. So we do a lot of data collection, and this is where they get, their money's worth. A lot of photos are taken. So for every entry that we have in the garden, usually a close-up, a farther back one, and then an even larger, more macroscopic photo. So at least three for every entry, at least July, August, and into September. And every 2 weeks, ideally from July through September, we're taking flowering data and heights and widths. And then, as I mentioned, in early August, which this last year was August 8th, we have a field day with about 300 to 350 industry members, professionals, master gardeners, all join us, and we get to enjoy the gardens and do an evaluation as well. And each person gets a small subset because evaluating over 1,000 plants in a few hours is not feasible. And then we have a second evaluation, which involves the subcommittee, or the, excuse me, the trial advisory committee, about a month later. And so we've taken all the numbers and those plants that kind of rise to the top. We look at those top ones a month later just to see if they're still the top plants or if there was like a quirky little anomaly there that we may need to adjust the top ratings. But that generally doesn't change. If they're performing well already into August, they probably are still going to be the best of those. And then that full report again comes in October, sometime middle to late October. And then we publish it on the web, and you should be able to find that here. If you scan those QR code, it should take you to our flower trial site. Let's see, move into the annuals. And just, Allison, should I wait to take any questions until we get towards the end?
You could, but I just have a clarifying question from someone. So the
Yep.
irrigation amounts you mentioned, are they the totals you're adding per week or per irrigation application?
Per week, per week.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's get to looking at plants, right? That's the fun part. So we'll start with the annuals, and most of what you're going to see are our best ofs. I've included a few plants that I thought were really nice and did well for performance that weren't necessarily voted as the best ofs. Okay, so we'll focus on a couple. We'll do containers, and we'll do a ground. And so our best container lantana, I'm guessing many of you have been hearing about lantana, it's been a very popular crop, was the hot-blooded red from Syngenta. And so one of the major breeding components for lantana over the last, decade or so is to make sterile selections. Older cultivars and species of lantana can be somewhat invasive, especially moved to the south southeast. But hot-blooded here was one of the more vigorous ones. And very, very floriferous. I'd say most all of our lantanas now are very floriferous over the much of the season. And so here you can see it, a great pollinator plant, averages, 15, 18 inches tall and about wide. So it's a little more dome shaped, and just flowered its little heart out. Okay, as we're out working the gardens, you can obviously go by the lantanas and you hear a lot of buzzing. So again, a lot of pollinators. And so this one was really the top lantana container. So if we move to the ground. Again, I'm not sure how folks could really discern from some of these. A lot of the lantana look great, but Lucky Sunrise rose from Ball Flora Plant got the top nod for best ground lantana. So very similar properties as we just saw with the hot blood. 12, 16 inches tall and about as wide, a little more of a mounding plant. Again, very floriferous. One thing about many lantanas, you'll see some of, let me use my little pointer here. The newer florets will open one color, and then as they start to mature, they fade. So we kind of get that multicolor effect. So you don't have to necessarily plant a yellow, orange, peach colored, plus a pinky magenta colored. You get the all like on one plant. The other thing about lantanas, certainly appreciate heat and more droughty conditions. So we could certainly dial back a little bit on moisture, and lantanas would be a great plant in the landscape for that. Best combo container. So when we look at the containers we have out there, there's kind of the growers or the breeders and the producers thinking of like a combination planter instead of having to buy three or four different species or cultivars and then, taking a 4, 3, 4, 5 inch plant and putting them all together. They will propagate them as cuttings and put two or three or four cuttings. All right. So in this case, this Mixmaster's Lucky Charm has this Lucky Flame, Lucky Sunrise Rose, which you just saw, and then Pot of Gold all in one plug. All right. So as they're coming from the greenhouse or in, they're being produced. All three of these are being produced in one plug or one pot container. And so in our combo containers, this Mixmaster's Lucky Charm was our top one. And usually how these best combos are reach that status is that there's good uniformity and good mixing of these. We don't necessarily see like one cultivar overtake another, or we see predominant one color for most of the pot. So this Mixmaster's Lucky Charm was our best combo container for the 2023 season. A Verbena bonariensis. This one did not win in our trials this year. It was an AAS, so All-American selection winner. This cultivar is Vanity. Gets a good, right around a 2 foot mark. If anybody's ever dealt with tall Verbena or Vervain, this can be the older selections for sure, and the species can be a little more invasive potential. They'd like to reseed. But Vanity is a little more under control. And so the thing about Vanity, this Verbena was very, very floriferous. So middle of summer all the way into early fall, we get this nice medium lavender purple color and kind of open, airy habit. So I call this a mingler plant. So if we put this like in the landscape, like you see planted here in the ground, other open, airy type plants planted next to it kind of start to grow together and they start to mingle quite well. Or if you have shorter plants that kind of fill near the ground, this Vanity can kind of fill in around it and bring some more height into it. And if you look at the lower right here, we have a container planting of this Verbena. And so great for pollinators as well. And another a good selection, I think, for the garden. This one didn't win either, but I wanted to throw this in there because over the season, late into the season, into early fall, so these Bidens were coming from Proven Winners, so they're Campfire series. So we have Campfire and Marshmallow here in the upper left in this right-hand photo, and then we have Flame, which is the other cultivar here, and then the close-ups here on the left in the center. I put those in there for a couple of reasons. These Bidens, slightly larger flowers, so we're over a quarter, take a typical quarter and almost double that in size. Nice red orangey fall color. So this brings nice color later into the season, very floriferous. You can see their overall habit here. So we have about 18 plants in these trial beds here. You can see they develop nice form to them. Again, it's an Asteraceae, so a lot of pollinators coming through. Self-cleaning, and what that means is they tend to take the older flowers, shed very easily, and allows new flowers to come up. And so we get low seed sets. So whenever we have low seed set, it usually is closer to a sterile plant. And the plant says, hey, well, I'm not making seeds, so I might as well make some more flowers with the hopes that I can make some seeds. So usually sterile plants in the landscape are helpful because it promotes more flowering. So I included that, but I want you to look at the next couple of photos. And so this one, it was taken at 2 weeks. 2 weeks after this photo you saw was this photo into middle of October. So we can see marshmallow here kind of flamed out there, all right? But this flame was still going quite strong into October. Sorry, this is a month later. So the previous one was taken September. This was a month later with flame, all right? And so we were pushing some decent fall color on this when much of the rest of the landscape was starting to really peter out there. Another one that didn't necessarily win, but it's made some photo covers of our magazines around the trade is this Gazania hybrids. So these sterling silver, these are coming from Greenfuse. And they were entered into our annual trial, but they do have some potential for hardiness. They are rated for USDA Zone 5. We've left them out there to see if they would overwinter this year, but so they're probably a marginal one. I would say they're probably going to overwinter if they're in a well-drained site, maybe a little more protected. And if we were to have a little more snow cover, I would say maybe this gazania would certainly overwinter. Unlike a lot of the other gazanias, if you're familiar, we don't necessarily see that double center kind of a situation where you have all the other petaloids in there. Usually most of our gazanias have 1 to 2 rows of petals or florets around the edge. So these are more of these double ones. This burgundy stripe has a nice linear lance shape, medium gray green colored foliage, so nice contrast. And here's sterling silver, and you can see in this left-hand photo both of the entries, so they're a little more carpet or ground cover forming plants. And so by midsummer and pretty solid flower, and the good low ground cover in the landscape. I'd say this would work perfect in mixed containers as well, sort of that filler spiller, if you will, kind of hanging out of the edge of the pot. Another reason I included those is here we have both burgundy stripe and sterling silver. Again, October 18th. So if we go back to the other photos about a month later, you can see some of the ash leaves that have colored and fallen here. So we did have late season color with these, and basically what stopped them was a really hard freeze. So again, maybe pushing some of that late color into the landscape. Also, one I wanted to highlight for those that might be doing, late season color planters, things like that. This wasn't a winner necessarily, but and some of you might be like, Solidago, really? Goldenrod? What's this guy thinking? This one I put in there because it's a little shorter. It's a day neutral one. So one thing about Greenfuse is they're breeding plants that don't necessarily respond to longer days or shorter days for flowering mechanism. You can see here on the right, these were put out in middle of June, and they already had flowers on them. And so those kind of faded. Then we got new shoots that came around them. And then by mid to late summer, we had about 18-inch tall plants that had more flowers on there as well. Okay. And so I wanted to highlight that because if anybody's creating like late season, fall type container planters, this spark plug Solidago might be an option for those. Again, it's a Solidago, which could be a hard sell for some, but it is a native in in parts of the United States. So that was one of those. Include this one. Some of you might recognize this Tylotus exaltatus, pink mulla mulla, or Joey, as it's sometimes fully referred to. This one is a native of Australia. This one will certainly handle heat and drought. And so there's a couple other things I want to include in our palette here of good plants. And so we were certainly giving it the 2 times a day, the 45 minutes of moisture application in the containers here. But I would say that even if it got half of that, it would do just as well. This one will prefer more dry conditions. And so you get these very fuzzy inflorescences, very similar to our amaranth, in the same family for that matter. But you have some of those bracts that show color. The true flowers are not as showy, but they will hold that color for a while in the landscape. And so these inflorescences, you can see, were quote unquote in flower for weeks on end. And I teach the plant ID courses and herbaceous plants in the fall. I was teaching this plant well into October. So that pinky magenta purple color, kind of a filler opportunity with a nice sort of soft a texture to it, with a little bit of cabbage-like leaves near the base, but something to be considered of. It does have a counterpart, Matilda, which I believe Benari is marketing as more of a cut flower. So something to be looking forward to. Our best novelty. All right. So when we decide our groups, if we have 10 entries or more in an individual species or genus, that's how we get a best of, say, lantana or a best of petunia. If we don't really have 10 of an individual species, we put them in the novelty group. And so this chrome fountain Centaurea in the Asteraceae looks very much like Dusty Miller. And so, which Dusty Miller is in the Asteraceae. The one thing to note, this mostly is typically aiming to be grown as a foliage type plant with that silver gray. It's very soft to the touch. Foliage, really not aimed to be marketed as a flowering annual, but I would argue that that has potential. It does have the, it comes in, if it flowers, it's in yellow. So many folks would already go ahead and cut these off before they even get to the larger flower stage in development. But if it does go into flower, we do get pollinators on them. And so we left this in the pot out in the gardens, actually. And I'm curious to, we'll see what the cold snap that we're going to get here, if it really does survive. It was looking all right a couple weeks ago, actually, without any irrigation happening. So I would think that there might be a hint of potential overwintering opportunity with this, but if not, at least some form and texture in the garden, if it was left out there, might be of interest. So, but great for mixed containers to do that contrast, with the foliage and that texture, that medium coarse sort of texture there. I tossed in so another area these folks will have commented because we have perennials in the annuals. That's a whole nother topic. But there's efforts to breed more dwarf perennial, even woody type shrubs. And a couple we had out there this year were the buddleias or the butterfly bushes. And I wanted to highlight these two coming from Greenfuse, the Leah series, Raspberry Midnight in the center there. And then, excuse me, Raspberry to the left and Midnight's in the center. But I wanted to highlight these because they are not invasive. They're sterile. They are not large. So these went we went from cuttings, so small little plants of like 2 to 3 inches, that we are received in like March into April, into about 18, 24 inches tall in one season. So these were 4-inch pots that were put out here. And by late July into early August, we're starting to get the first flowers. Then all of August into September, we had really nice flowering displays and slight decent fragrance and lots of pollinators. So, but Leah does have tend to have a bad rap, but if it one is sterile, we don't have issues. But one goal, I think Greenfuse was aiming these to be used for mixed containers and/or hanging baskets because it has a little lower profile with these. So I know, I think I highlighted another one. Yeah, I did here. Benari has buddleias as well that they aimed more for containers. You can see the bird pink here on the left. So by mid-July is when it's really coming into flower, and then bird violet here too, very similar. So by September, we're kind of on the outswing there. The previous But Leah, with the Leahs from Greenfuse, probably pushed it a little bit later. So starting to see more of that overlap of woody ornamentals and perennials and just looking at fun, beautiful plants. So this one did not win. I'm surprised it didn't, but I wanted to highlight it because personally, as I walk through the garden almost every day, I walk through at least twice to and from the office or to the gardens. This Pinnata gamfrina, globe amaranth, from Ball Ingenuity, a nice, rich magenta color, nice upright form, held its stems upright. Obviously, with many of our gamfrina, we see the bracts in full flower, if you will, for several months. But and these two pictures here don't do it justice. Just as the sun's coming up in the morning and just coming over the trees into the gardens, this little patch would just light up because the light was reflecting through these bracts. And then the same thing at the late afternoon. It's only for a few minutes, but that whole trial entry would just light up, and you could see it, like it would stand out from across the garden, across the street. And so I thought that was a really nice plant for attraction in the garden. And of course, pollinators and many of our gamfrinas also like lower water inputs and can handle hot or warmer and drier conditions. Let's see, I'm about halfway-ish through, so I'm doing pretty good. We'll get to the perennials here soon. I'm just going to highlight a couple of the rudbeckias or sunbeckias. So might say rudbeckias are typically a perennial. They are. It seems a lot of shift to move these to like short-lived perennials or annuals, and so that's what Bull Genetics has done. The best ground rudbeckia of 2023 was Luna, and so Luna here, you can see as it matures, we'll get some of that more coppery tones in there. See it down here. I would say the rudbeckia this year did do. If anybody visited the gardens, we saw the rudbeckia probably lodge a little bit more than it should have. We were natural precipitation a lot more than normal, which we basically turned off our irrigation for much of the summer because we weren't going to just irrigate for the sake of it. But we did because we couldn't control obviously the downpours we had. I do think the rudbeckia lodged just a little bit more than they would have if we were more normal and warm and a little bit drier with us controlling the irrigation. And flip side to the containers, we had Juliana. And so Juliana here with more of that green center, green yellow center with the eyes, if you will. Juliana was the top pot performer, and I believe Juliana was the best ground rudbeckia of 2022. So basically, this whole series of the Sunbeckia series from Bull Genetics are a pretty decent lineage of rudbeckias. Larger flowers, some of these were easily approaching 4 to maybe even 6 inches in diameter. Okay. And very upright for the most part, again, considering the amount of natural precipitation that we're getting. I do want to highlight one seed series because if folks came through later in the season, they would have seen that sunspot yellow here was definitely more compact, a little bit shorter, probably about 18 to 24 inches. But that one started as a seed, so it just started slower into the garden. The seed varieties coming out into the garden are generally a little smaller than the vegetative. And so, coming on late into the season, I did want to highlight this Pan American seed sunspot yellow as a good seed variety. It was compact, great color, floriferous, and did show a little bit less lodging, but of course, it came on a little bit later. Our best Angelonia has been a very popular annual over recent years was the Area Alta Raspberry from Dooman. Pictures probably don't do justice here. This, at least on my screen, show a little more purple. It's probably more magenta, closer to that raspberry color. One of the major goals in Angelonia breeding is to try to get us to a true red color. And so these raspberries and deep magentas are taking us closer to that. But very floriferous. Angelonias love the heat. All right. And so this one flowered and flowered and flowered. You can see here in this one picture maybe a little bit of chlorosis happening. Again, we tried to be able to fertilize through our irrigation as we could, but sometimes when we get the natural precipitation, we weren't able to water slash fertilize. And so I'd say a few crops started to show a little bit of hungry nature just because we weren't able to get as much fertilization on them as possible, but nonetheless, still did quite well. Our best salvia has been pretty popular as well. This Mystic Spiders from Ball Flora Plant. This was close to the bike path out in the gardens. This one just flowered and flowered and flowered. You can see the racemes here. Some of these were easily approaching 2 feet. So the number of florets on there was, approaching hundreds for some of these. And you could just hear the bees and other pollinators. It was a buzz. All right. This whole patch just sort of vibrated. But a nice, medium blue, deep bluish hint to the calyxes there. For this one, and nice foliage, and kept upright. All right, so this got to a total of probably about 3 feet tall, but just didn't lodge very much, considering as much extra moisture as we got as well. So that was our top salvia. Because I am a bold person, I wanted to include this one. This is an alocasia. This one didn't win any awards. This one came from Plant Nouveau, but one thing we don't necessarily put a lot in the landscape of are very coarse textured plants. We don't have really large leaf plants that many necessarily here. But this Borneo King, if you look to the right, you'll see some other alocasias that we put in the garden. But this Borneo King here, so you can see at least two or three very large leaves, and those are probably 2.5 to maybe 3 feet would be pushing it in height. But they started as 4-inch transplants, and so they were, if you look at the lower leaves of this one back here, were more that size as they went into the garden, and so they did grow fairly well, even for being, a lot of the alocasias and arums do appreciate a bit more humidity, and so we're very dry, so that can actually slow them down. But I think if we'd actually had a little more heat early on with the amount of moisture we had, these might have actually got another maybe two leaves on them, so they would approached easily a solid 4 feet tall. So I wanted to highlight those because I would, say putting those in a container, and then if you had the ability to move them into a maybe an unheated garage, or they do develop that cormous tuber root down below, you could get them to grow from year to year. But nonetheless, in 1 year, getting a 4-ish foot tall, sort of very coarse leaf plant could be of interest. So I have about 20 minutes, not even 15-ish minutes. So I'm going to go through a couple perennials here. This is the old Fort Collins High School, and our perennials are in the front or to the west of that generally. So just a few notes about the perennial trials. They start in 2006. Plants are trialed for 3 years. We get 3 summers and 2 winters out of them. So we give them survival percentages. We have about 20-ish companies and breeders participating. We receive them mostly as larger plugs, liners. They go out as 4-inch plants. And basically, the whole garden in the individual zones, they get 1.5 inches per week, which is usually done over 2 to 3 waterings. And again, very similar fertilization applications, pre-plant Osmocote, and then a general 21-20 over the fertigations. Again, very similar data collection. We take a lot of photos. We collect flowering and plant data every month, May through September. We have a student that does record specific data, but we also have a subcommittee from our advisory committee that's focused more on perennials. They will try to also come at least once a month to try to provide some more data for our ultimate report. And then we do give a top performers, and that report comes out. And again, full report is published. And again, you can find that on our website. I believe we actually post the last 3 years' worth of reports. Sorry if this feels like a whirlwind, but it is. We have so many fun plants to talk about. I'm only going to scratch the surface. So our 2023 top performers for this year, this is the list. We had 9 of them, 2, 4, 6, 8, or 8 of them, that you can see here. So we had a Brunnera, and I'll focus on a couple of these as we go through. We had an Echinacea. So Echinaceas is a very large genus in the breeding effort. So we usually have Echinacea in the gardens, and we usually have where the flocks go here, the Kapau from Darwin's. And actually, Kapau White did well last year, I believe. So we definitely have, Echinacea and phlox and heucheras. Those are three major genera. Sedums, there's still a lot of work going on there. And I think Allison had that picture of the beefeater lupine in the introduction slide, but that one was a stunner. So there's the list of those, and you can also find those in the report. Just kind of like these a little bit, some of these a little more individually. Here's this Brunnera Alexandria. So this silvery gray foliage, in just the right light, the way it hits it, it can actually have that more metallic look. So if you're looking for that partial shade or very open shade, probably consistently well drained would be good, but probably will handle a little bit more dry down. But then those little forget-me-not, light blue, pastel blue flowers, which come on late spring, very early summer, and then it kind of they'll kind of subside, and new growth will come up and around, and so we have more of that foliage interest for comparing and contrasting other plants in the landscape. So Alexandria was that one, and kind of came in just over a foot tall, and so you can see a nice display here of those. Here's the Beefeater lupin. All right, so if anybody's worked with lupins, usually have a very short sort of span, more in the front end of the gardening season, late spring into very early summers when we're seeing these. Mid-spring, very early summer is about the end. But this one, again, I don't think the photos on this, they're great, but I don't think they do it the justice of the intense. And so anybody that takes photos recognizes it's hard to really capture that red magenta color. But this is one heard several folks say it was a you'd be driving by and it would catch your eye, right? It's a stoplight. See it across the garden and be like, what's that over there? And so these large, these inflorescences, these spikes would easily approach a solid foot, almost 2 feet for some of these, with hundreds of little florets, and that sort of popsicle shape there. And then they basically will peter out, and so by midsummer we basically just have the foliage, and the foliage actually, with the ability for that hydrophobic, the water to bead up, kind of maybe is a small addition to the landscape. But I actually showed students decent looking foliage all the way into October, and so. But if you're aiming for that cottage garden style, this one would fit that for sure. Great color. Sedums. This one from Proven Winners, Walter Gardens, and Hans Hansen. Beautiful dark blackish purple foliage with that mid to late summer flowering. These corums coming up with the peachy pinkish color, maybe a little bit of white hint to them. With the amount of moisture we had this last year, this photo you see on the left was from this year. This past year, didn't lodge. So oftentimes with like sedums and some other plants that appreciate less moisture, that are really succulent, with too much moisture can rot out and or get really leggy. This one held up quite well. It did well for all 3 years in its trial. So another opportunity to do, contrasting foliage in the landscape, and pollinators were all over this one as well. So right around that 18-inch mark, maybe pushing into that 2-foot mark for this sedum. Here's an echinacea, a little bit more compact. This one coming from Bull Genetics, Flamingo Holland. This one was selected. You can see some level of the uniformity or that compactness, and very nice coloration to the flower, the composite heads. And one thing folks noted was a little bit of the darker purplish color coming in on the base of the inflorescences that helped kind of pull it through. But by midsummer, good color. Weeks of color. All right. So you can see even here we have additional flowers coming through. So it pulled color through the landscape quite well and quite long. And you can see another cultivar next to this one here in the center picture that wasn't coming on as early. So this one's a little bit on the front end of the season there, but held through. Let's see, where I'm at with time. Okay. I'm going to save at least a few minutes for potential questions. So I threw this one here. This wasn't a 2023 top performer, but it was a 2022. It's a plant selected. It's the Thermopsis, the Golden Candles. So very lupin-like as well, same family. The inflorescences weren't as dense, like the typical lupin, but this one we took out this last spring. We let it flower first. Very similar to the Beefeater Lupin, this one was a showstopper. It would, cause people to break. And this one wasn't too far from the Beefeater, but wanted to put this one in there because one, a plant select, and also this one will handle lower water inputs, more drier situation. This, the lupin, after it's done flowering, it's pretty much a green vegetative shrub-like. And so just have to wait for the following season. But that one was a top performer of last year. A couple that were put in this year that I wanted to highlight that are coming up. This Rudbeckia Sweet as Honey, the Black-Eyed Susan. The Sweet as Honey coming from Intrinsic, a breeder up in Illinois. You can see these 4-inch pots were coming out and they were already flowering. And by the end of the summer, they had really filled in their trial area and a little more delicate, I would say, looking black-eyed Susan with the ray florets a little more narrow, all right, and so not quite as large and flat, so a little more open and hairy. But I hope to see more good things coming out of this. Also supposed to be more resistant to some of the leaf spot pathogens like Septoria and things like that that we often see with some of the black-eyed Susans. Here's a Buddaluya. All right, we have Blonde Ambition out there as well, which is very, very popular from Plant Select. But Honeycomb, this one, this is 1 year. All right, so again, filled in quite nicely from 4-inch pots. Cold Hardy, it's 24 to 30 inches. Again, catch it in the right light. These slides don't do it justice, but just right in the morning, it just kind of lit up that whole plot. And again, drought adaptation. Maybe the major difference between this and Blonde Ambition is maybe the density of it, and the amount of flowers coming through on this one. But Honeycomb, I think we'll see more of that in the future here. So, and then here's even late into the season. So this was just a couple days into the. Was it November, I believe? So even for winter interest, this grass would be suitable. Let's see. I have a couple more, and then I'm going to have to stop for questions here. Agastache or Agastache, Agastache, however you want to say it. This one, 2023 entry was really a showstopper already. Probably destined to be one of the top performers, perhaps. But very floriferous, nice form on the plants, great for pollinators, and so probably going to see more of this pink pearl in the next couple of years. Yes, another echinacea, but these are hybrid seed series from Kieft Seed, the artisans, and so these are essentially going from seed to full flower. Like these, this is year two, but they even flower in year one. But very, very floriferous, and there's the red ombre, the yellow ombre, there's soft orange. And so this is a series to be looking for if you're interested in perhaps seed propagation of them. Here's a Centaurea so we saw a Centaurea back in the annuals, the fancy frills. This is a silver swirl snowflake Centaurea that by Darwin Perennials, that's reported to be a perennial. So basically much of the same things that we saw with the other Centaurea in the annuals, much of the same color, the form, leaf shape. So we'll see how this one overwinters here. That was a new one this year. Let's see. Do I have a couple left? There's a couple Galleardias out there. The Gusto series. They were flowering quite well into the middle, late part of the season. Saffron. Like many of the Galleardias, we do see them kind of open up a little bit. But I would beautiful color, the saturation on there with that light orangey gold color and the yellow just stood out. And so we'll see how they come through this winter to see if what their third year looks like with them. And another reason I threw them in there was you can see here this is October 17th, so even late, we're talking about added late season color here. You can see lemon over here is very floriferous into the middle of October. So Delasperma, that's a major crop. It's a big crop. There's several in Plant Select, but Danziger had this ember. This lower picture right here, I personally thought it was like a goner. So you can see there's probably one, two, three, four, five small remnants of plants there. So that was back into late April, early May, if I recall. And then by middle of summer, this larger picture here, it filled out quite well. So I wanted to highlight that one bounced back quite well. And then even into September, or excuse me, October, this ember was flowering, its little heart out. So I wanted to highlight that one. So maybe this one will be one of the top performers next year, as that will round it out. And then I need to highlight this one. This was mesmerizing. This is Feathers Peacock Salvia, again in its second year. I took this photo from a top. You can see down the lower right here, but very uniform and wonderful soft pink color. Probably a little on the shorter flowering side of things for just a couple of weeks, and then it's not as attractive, but during that period, kind of mesmerizing. And with many of the salvias, also very much a pollinator type sort of plant. So, Feathers Peacock to the left there, and then Flamingo right here. The Flamingo one I thought was a little more tidy, a little more compact, and maybe a little more mesmerizing than the peacock there to the left. So, that is a whirlwind. I went through that quite fast. It's hard to really pick a lot of those. If you have any questions, I'll entertain some right now. There's the website. Please visit the trials. We're in the process right now of getting the 2024 entries. I'm receiving at least a couple a day right now. Haven't had the chance to really look at each individual entry yet, but I think we're gonna have some other, nice fun ones out there. Obviously, we'll get a lot of petunias and calibrachoas and things like that, but there should be some fun things coming through yet again this year. And so would invite you to visit us. And with that, Allison, Tony, I can take some questions.
Yeah, thank you, Chad. Do you mind turning your camera on too?
Oh, yes, I can. Here we go. Sorry. It's been a while since I've actually done a solid like webinar. So.
So a couple of questions specifically to lupine. Any noted characteristics about resistance to aphids? I looked at the report and looks like you had a little bit of powdery mildew at the end of the year. Not surprising, but.
Yes, so there was actually we did have some aphids. So this beef eater was not resistant necessarily to aphids. We did have a small little I wouldn't go far to say an outbreak of it, but we noticed some aphids that were starting. And so since it was early in the season and it seemed like we were on the moist side of things, yet we did do an application of to control the aphids on that one.
Okay. And then another question about the lupine is, are these cultivars generally sterile or can they reseed like some of our native lupines?
Great question. As any question can be said, it can be complicated. I would say the vast majority of our newer plants, annuals and perennials that are coming out, are on the side of more sterile, less seed production. As I kind of noted in like with the Bidens and the campfire flame, if we breed for sterility or lack of seed production, the plant is like, hey, I mean, one of the major points of plants and their life cycle is to reproduce, right? Reproduce seeds or reproduce asexually through offsets. And so if we basically through our breeding process remove the seed production side, the plant doesn't necessarily know any better. And so they're like, oh my gosh, I'm not making seed. I need to make more flowers to make seed, right? And so with that being said, a lot of the newer plants, especially when you highlight, I highly like a buddleia and other known plants that can be very fecundant and produce a lot of seeds. It's like a win-win situation. We don't get explosive amounts of seedlings coming up. We might get a few here and there. It's not always, always a chance that there could be a fertile floret or two or 17, right? So you might get a few. But I would say it, the vast majority of our newer plants that are coming out have been bred for that sterility to control overseeding, but also to exacerbate our interest, which is their flowers. So I think I've answered that question.
That's awesome.
Okay.
And would you say the lupines were biennials or were they true perennials in the trials? I realize we only had them for like 3 years.
Right. So coming in with them already being in there, I would say They are more of a perennial. And so we'll see this next spring just how much, because it had been their second season this last year. So we'll see this next season just how many were perennialized in that regard. And
Fantastic.
I would say that's another thing as we look at the breeding efforts of a lot of the folks that are doing the work is we don't want them to be biennial. We'd rather see them be that more perennial kind of a situation. But then if you go back to their seed production, if they're more biennial, the goal would be producing the seed so that way the old mother plants that are dying away, right, that the new seedlings are taking their spot, so we kind of have that constant lupine display or whatever, insert whatever plant it is, kind of a thing.
Lori would like to know the best time to visit. I'm biased, but I'd be interested in your perspective.
Well, it depends on what you want to see. I would say if you had to pick one time to visit, probably the 3rd week of July, that's when you'll see at least a good show in perennials. The annuals are really starting to hit their mark. And so I would say that middle of July sort of side. Now, that's where you can hit a lot. That'd be my answer. But come back more than once. So then you can come in like, late May into early June to see some of the irises coming through, the lupins, and then come back after we get the annuals in and they're coming on. And then even some of the later, season perennials in the demonstration garden, you could see a lot as well. So.
And then maybe the last question for today is, there have been some shade trials, or continuous dappled shade trials. Do you plan to continue those with species?
Yes. So we have the shade trials with the annuals, so we have the permanent shade structure. And so we definitely will continue with the annual shade trials there. We have the challenge of the honey locusts overgrowing, so to keep a consistent shade. So I know last year Dr. Klett had those pruned. We probably need to do it again. And with the perennials, we're using the natural shade from those elm trees over there. So we have to kind of go at the whims of what the ultimate shade they're providing. But long story short is yes. My goal is to continue those, and my goal is to try to get more shade entries because we do have perennials that are over there that have been trialed. They've been out of the formal trial for a while now, but because of our agreement to have color or plant interest there, we leave them in. But I'm trying to poke at certain breeders to be like, hey, let's see some new perennials for the shade. And I might get ridiculed for this, but I might say even a new hosta over there just to see something new over there. So,
We'll see how drought tolerant hosta really can be.
I,
So with that, a big thanks to Dr. Chad Miller for joining us today. Please come again and join us. Our next seminar will be Wednesday, February 14th at noon. Cassie and I will talk about our totally biased perennial selection. Probably repeat a couple that Chad has mentioned, but we would love to have you. I'll put that in the chat. Chad will also likely be reaching out with a short survey so you can give him some feedback on your thoughts on this presentation. But we're really thrilled to have you aboard, not only at CSU, but in Extension as well. So thank you, Chad. Any
appreciate it.
comments, Tony?
Nope, no comments.
All
Great
right, so
background.
we will post this to the cohort's website and look for that in about a week or so. Give us a few days. Otherwise, thanks everybody, and hope your 2024 is off to a great start.
Perfect. Thanks, everybody.